So, good afternoon, everybody. And first of all, thanks to the organizers for the kind invitation. And this is the first talk in this section dedicated to the Bodoxino results. So, in my talk, I will talk about detector performances. And as an introduction, I just review a bit which is the aim of the experiment and which were the choices for its design. So the main goal of the Bodoxino experiment is the detection of low energy solar neutrinos. In particular, it was designed to detect beryllium-7 neutrinos. The detector method that was chosen is the elastic scattering of neutrinos on electrons. So, as you can see here, neutrinos scatter off electrons, and we are sensitive to all the flavors of neutrinos, so electron, muon, tau. And the location experiment that is taking data since 2007 is Laboratorio Nazionale Regina Sasso in Italy. So, at the end of the day, the detection medium is a large mass of organic liquid scintillator. So, a mass of a liquid that is able to show particle interaction through Z-excitation. Sorry, I just closed the window here. Okay, there's some noise. So, which is the problem of this kind of experiment? The problem is that the cross-section of interaction of neutrinos of the scatter of electrons is small. If we are thinking about beryllium-7 neutrinos and taking the standard solar model, we expect the order of 50 counts per day in 100 tons of liquid scintillator. That corresponds to about 10 to the minus 9 becquerel per kilogram. So, for comparison, if we take some tap water, we will find about 1 becquerel per kilogram in uranium, thorium, and potassium. So, to have a good signal-to-noise ratio, we have to have a huge radio purity levels in the detector. And so, add all the strategies that are typical of low background experiments. And I review a bit them. These are not just peculiar of Bodoxino, but it's, let's say, a common way to design this kind of experiment. So, for what concerns the background mitigation strategies, we want to reduce both the external background, so the background that's coming from the lab and environment, and the internal background, so the background coming from materials of the experiment. So, to reduce the external background, we have to go underground to mitigate the effect of the cosmic rays and to add some passive shielding to the experiment. For reduce the internal background, we have to reduce the mass close to the active medium, so in this case, close to the scintillator. We have to select the materials that we want to use. And so careful screening and selection of materials. And in this case, since we are talking about the liquid, we can also think about the purification of the liquid itself. So first of all, Bodoxino takes place at the Laboratorio Nazionale di Gran Sasso. It's an underground laboratory. Its altitude is 963 meters above the sea level. And it has an average rock cover of about 1,400 meters. So it means that we have a shielding capability that corresponds to about 3,800 water equivalent meters. And the muon flux is reduced by a factor 10 to the 6 with respect to surface. We expect something like 1 muon per square meter per hour. Of course, there are several laboratories in the world, and you can find here Laboratorio Nazionale di Gran Sasso. So let's have a view of how Brexino is made. So the core are 280 tons of PC plus PPO, so liquid scintillator, that is contained in a 125 micrometers thick nylon vessel. The fiducial mass, so after applying cut due to the analysis, is the order of 100 tons. The pure scintillator is decoupled from a radioactive point of view from the construction materials using 900 tons of quenched scintillator. So having a quencher, basically the scintillator that's contained here does not scintillate, and so it's used as passive shielding. Everything is contained in a stainless steel sphere, and 2,212 internal PMTs look for scintillation light. The whole thing is then contained in a water Cherenkov tank, and in this tank, 2.8 kiloton of ultrapure water is present that acts as a passive shielding for gammas and neutrons, and an active veto for muons, thanks to the Cherenkov effect. And there are PMTs looking for this light. Here, you can find a couple of pictures. The first one is taken from the inside. A camera, or maybe a set of cameras, are installed on the stainless steel sphere, and you can see in the background all the PMTs with the light concentrators. You can see the vessels and the scintillator. This picture here on the right is taken from the lab. You can see the dome of the Brexino and the thermal insulation applied to the water Cherenkov tank. We said that we had to fight against background. You can see here a list of contaminants and background sources. And I will not go through all of them, but just a few examples. The first one are muons, and we can lower their effect just going underground and use a water Cherenkov tank. Another contaminant is carbon 14, that the usual amount is 10 to the minus 12 gram per gram, while we require 10 to the minus 18 gram per gram. And we can achieve it with some strategy that is selecting the oil from very deep wells where the amount of carbon 14 is negligible. And a third example is krypton 85, that is containing the air due to nuclear reaction and fallout. The typical amount is 1 becquerel per cubic meter, and we have to remove it with a stripping and to operate the detector during the construction in a controlled environment. So basically, the Brexino works looking for scintillation light and detecting it. So we have, as I said, 2,212 PMTs. And from the light, we can get the particle identification. So if the light was emitted by electron or by an alpha, for instance, looking at the profiles of light versus time, we can understand the energy of the event from the total light collected, and also the event position applying algorithms of time of flight. Unfortunately, since scintillation happens at the molecular level, there is no directionality, and the performances are 50 keV at 1 MeV of energy, so 5%, and 10 centimeter at 1 MeV and all position resolution. And these quantities are tested with a calibration campaign. Here you can see the profile of PPO emission spectrum, and post with the PMT quantum efficiency, and you see that are well matched the two. In this plot, I show you the profile of light versus time for alpha and beta particles, and understanding the different profiles of light versus time, we can develop algorithm to discriminate between them. And for example, here is one of the several parameters that we developed. This is a multi-layer perceptron parameters that is able to disentangle of the order of 10 to the 5 alphas from betas from bismuth polonium couples. And also we were able to develop a parameter to discriminate between electrons and positrons, exploiting the fact that positrons are point like emission, while positrons annihilate and so emits two gammas. And this makes the likelihood of the position reconstruction algorithm less precise. And looking at the likelihood, we can get some discrimination power between the two. How we test all this? We tested everything with calibration campaigns. We had several calibration campaigns from 2008 to 2010, where sources were developed with, were deployed with arms and hinge here, where you can see at the bottom a vial with alpha sources or beta or gamma sources, and also a light that is detected by the camera system, so we know exactly where we put the source. This system with the arm let us place the source on all this position in red inside the vessel. And we perform a test with this kind of vial, that contains an aberration beryllium source, so a neutron source, but also with a source that is placed at the level of stainless steel sphere to understand the external background. Here is the list of the sources that we deployed inside the scintillator. The gamma one are used to test the energy scale, and alpha one for uniformity of the response. The neutron source is important for the energy scale and for, let's say, tuning, understanding the analysis for neutron capture. And then we performed also some laser runs. And here is a map of all the positions that we tested. We developed different energy estimators. The number of PMT that see light, the number of its integrated over all the PMTs, and the charge. You can see that the charge is more linear, while the three estimators are quite similar at low energy. For what concerns the position reconstruction, the position is calculated using a time of flight algorithm. And then we wrote a likelihood that is minimized to understand the position of the interaction. Since the shape of the signal changes with the number of photoelectrons that has been detected, this is taken into account at an analysis level. And here you can find a plot with the resolution that we obtain as a function of the total charge. We compared the position of the source that we deployed with the one calculated from the algorithm, and we see that we have no bias in X and Y, while we have up to 4 centimeters in the center on the Z. This is taken into account at the analysis level, and also the impact on the fiducial volume determination is lower than 0.2%. Another point that we have to take into account when we look at the Borexino performances is the performance that we have understanding the vessel shape. In fact, we have a small, just because we have a small leak in the vessel, this causes the vessel shape to evolve with time. And so we have to take it into account during the analysis. And how we can do it and reconstruct the shape. Basically, we look at the 800-800 keV window. So where mostly events from bismuth, potassium, and thallium that are sticked on the vessel is present. And we can understand this shape, reconstruct it, and consequently reconstruct the position of the vessel with an uncertainty of 1%, or let's say plus or minus 5 centimeters. And this method has been cross-checked with pictures that has been taken with cameras. And the vessel shape is updated every 3 weeks. We made also some runs where we test the trigger efficiency with the lance of LED, of light at different intensity. And we tuned the number of PMT that has to be to see a hit in the first 99 nanoseconds to have a hardware threshold of 50 to 60 keV, so way lower than analysis threshold. And the fact that at the analysis energy, the efficiency is close to 100% and is compatible with 100% has been cross-checked with a strontium source. I want to use the last few minutes that I have to talk about also the modeling that we developed. We have two independent models. One is Monte Carlo and one is analytical. The Monte Carlo one is based on a Gen 4 package. And then we have a custom C++ simulation of the electronics. And the performances of the simulation have been validated with a calibration campaign. So when we wrote the code and we tuned it, we start developing the response of the scintillation for alphas from the calibration sources. We tuned the material reflectivity and light collection in order to get the absorption lens right. At this point, we worked on the beta scintillation times and energy scale, and the alpha scintillation times and energy scale. And once all this was fixed, we worked on the electronic simulation parameters. All the approach and the tuning parameters are reported in this paper. And as you can see here, in blue are data, in black are data, in blue are Monte Carlo. You can see the comparison between Monte Carlo and data for calibration sources in the center for the three energy estimators. Here, using events from Polonium 210, we look at the response of the Monte Carlo in comparison with data. In the place where the analysis happens, so in the fiducial volume, and you can see that we are in agreement better than 99%, so the disagreement is less than 1%, actually, or the order of 0.8% in the fiducial volume, while for that is used for a solar analysis, while for other analysis that exploited the full mass of the scintillator, we used americium-beryllium runs, since we are also interested in higher energy events. And you can see that we are in agreement of the order of 2% in the whole scintillator, using exactly the 2.2 MeV gammas coming from the neutron capture. Then we also developed an algorithm to simulate external background events. And you can see the good agreement between data and Monte Carlo. We placed the source in several positions on the synthetic sphere, and we are able to reproduce the ratio between the photo absorption peak and the tail for the 2.6 thallium gammas. And this is important because it means also that we are able to reproduce the vessel shape.
Yes,
and this is the plot for the times and for the position reconstruction. We developed also an analytical model, and the aim is to develop a energy PDF from the model. This model takes into account the scintillation light, the Cherenkov photons, and the non-uniformity on the light collection. So the model is quite complicated. It is described in this paper. There are lots of parameters, for example, the fraction of Cherenkov light, the threshold on the Cherenkov light, and parameters that take into account the non-uniformity. And so at the end, we have two models, independent models that works really well. And this gives really robustness to the analysis that you will hear about later in the next talks. So I come to my conclusions. So Brexino is a liquid scintillator detector that was tailored to the solar neutrino detection. Actually, it made a lot of nice results also in not strictly related solar neutrino physics, and is currently in data taking phase at the Laboratorio Nazionale del Gran Sasso. At the energy taken into account in analysis, the trigger efficiency is 100%. We have a resolution of 50 keV at 1 MeV and 10 centimeters in spatial dimension. And we developed the models that agree within 1% with data in the solar energy range and in the solar fiducial volume. So these are these performances are really important because enable Brexino to deliver the results on physics that you will hear about in the next talks. And that's it. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Alessio, for this clear explanation of Brexino's characteristic. Questions? Comments? No, so thank you, Alessio. Thank you again.
Thank you. Bye.
So I think that you can remove the sharing of the screen. Thank you. And we give the word to Alessandra. And this talk is about unveiling the engine of the sun, measurements of a PP chain solar neutrinos with Brexino. Please, Alessandra.
So good afternoon. Well, as Gioacchino said, I'm going to talk about the results obtained by the Brexino collaboration, especially concerning the measurement of the PP chain solar neutrinos. We know that our sun shines in neutrinos, and this is due to the fusion reactions that occur in its core, and that can be summarized by this equation, with a net release of an energy net release of about 26 MeV. Neutrinos interact only through weak interaction and at the mean energy of the solar neutrinos. This means with a cross section of about 10 to the minus 44 square centimeter. Given the neutrino elusiveness, we know that they are a very powerful tool to study any astrophysical object. Considering the sun's case, for instance, we know that a photon massively interacts with the solar plasma and take about 10 to the 5 years to reach our sun, our star surface. Instead, neutrinos, given their nature, only take about the famous 8 minutes to travel from their production site straight forward to the solar surface and then to the Earth. Solar neutrinos are so the most unique, natural and plentiful tool we have to perform solar neutrino spectroscopy. That actually is the only way to get a real snapshot of the sun and to have and study through real-time information. Solar neutrinos are the neutrinos emitted during the two processes that make our sun, our star to burn, the PB chain and the CNO cycle. In particular, for stars having a sun-like mass, the PB chain is responsible of about the 99% of the energy release, while the CNO cycle for the remaining 1%. In the PB chain, we have the so-called PP neutrino, PEP neutrino, the HEP neutrino, and then the beryllium 7 and boron 8 neutrino. Instead, as regards the CNO cycle, we have neutrinos coming from the reactions involving nitrogen, oxygen, and fluorine. These neutrinos fluxes are well described by the so-called standard solar model, which is a complex container where input parameters such, for instance, the sun luminosity, age, mass, radius, cross-sections, opacity, and metallicity are considered all together and results in expectations about the neutrino solar fluxes and the Hadley seismology. There are currently two scenarios. Which arise according to the different metallicity inputs, the high or the low metallicity inputs. In a star, the metallicity is the abundance of elements heavier than helium. About heliosismology, which is the study of the structure and dynamics of the sun through the propagation of the sun's wave over the surface, there are quite different predictions according to the different metallicity inputs. About solar neutrino fluxes, the scenario results in different prediction of the solar neutrino fluxes according to the high or low metallicity. What is worth to see is that for some species, there is basically no difference between the two predictions, but for neutrinos coming from beryllium 7, boron 8, and CNO, we do expect a difference which arises from 9% up to about 30%. So to experimentally measure neutrino fluxes and to study helioseismology is the only way we have to check the understanding and the mechanism of the nuclear processes at the center of our sun. The solar neutrino energy spectrum stands up to about 20 MeV. Here you see the spectrum of each neutrino species with its theoretical uncertainty according to the most up-to-date solar model. Introducing Borexino, its original goal, as already said by Alessio, was the measurement of the beryllium 7 solar neutrino flux. But then, through the years, Borexino turned out to be a very powerful experiment, able to test and measure neutrinos in all the energy range connected to the solar neutrinos, so all neutrinos. Due to the very small neutrino interaction rate, when we talk about neutrino physics, we talk about rare event physics, the shielding against cosmic rays and the experiment extreme radio purity are mandatory. Solar neutrinos experiments can be carried out in underground laboratories only. And that's why Borexino is located in the whole sea of the Laboratori Nazionali del Gran Sasso, a place that can guarantee an average rock cover of about 1,400 meters, that is roughly equivalent to a shield against cosmic rays of about 3,800 meter water equivalent. This yield, the muon flux, to be reduced by a factor 10 to the 6 with respect to what we measure in surface at the Laboratorio Nazionale del Gran Sasso. And in Borexino, we have a muon rate of about 1 muon per square meter per hour. Here, there is a very a sketch of the Borexino experiment, which helps, as already Alessio described, to fulfill the constraint of a very high radio purity for our measurement. You see here, going from the outside towards the inside, we have this graded shielding, we have the water tank, which is a muon water Cherenkov probe detector, and that's also as muon and neutron shield. Then we have the stainless steel sphere over which 2,200 photomultipliers are installed, looking inwards. And then we have the non-scintillating buffer, a first nylon vessel, again the buffer, a second nylon vessel, and then the core of the Borexino detector, which are 280 tons of liquid scintillator. Let's now see how it's possible to extract a neutrino signal. In this plot, you see an example of the Borexino energy spectrum in NPMT's DT1, which is one of our energy estimator, of the energy estimator we use in our collaboration. Roughly, 1 MeV corresponds to about 400 NPMTs. Even at the Borexino very high radio purity condition, we still have backgrounds contaminating our solar neutrino signal, and we need to apply software cuts to our data in order to remove as much as possible the background. Here you see we can, via software, remove muons. Now we have the spectra in blue. And then we can select a fiducial volume to be sure to avoid the backgrounds coming from the external background, the background coming from the PMTs, basically, and from the vessel itself. And also we can apply an algorithm to subtract and identify and subtract the most dangerous cosmogenical background, which is the carbon 11. Moreover, we still need a powerful tool to separate what is the residual background, what are the residual background components from the signal. The algorithm we use to tag the main dangerous cosmogenic background, this carbon 11, is called threefold coincidence. The threefold coincidence technique is fundamental to improve the fit capability to disentangle the carbon 11 contamination from the PEP and CNO neutrino signal. Briefly, every time we have a muon crossing the active scintillator zone, there is a chance that the muon will interact with a carbon 12 atom of our scintillator, producing carbon 11 together with some cosmogenic neutrons. We can exploit the time and space correlation of the muons and the neutrons they produce in combination with the carbon 11, the subsequent carbon 11 decay itself, and we obtained a likelihood that a certain event is really carbon 11. So, just to summarize, what is the status of the Borexino experiment when we attempt the comprehensive solar neutrino spectroscopy of the PP chain? We could count on improved radio purity because of the purification campaign performed in the past. We can count on increased statistics and stability of the detector. The detector is very stable. And of course, we can count on a better comprehension of the details of the energy scale and detector response. So, all this given, it was possible for us for the first time to perform a simultaneous fit on the whole solar neutrino energy region. This analysis was carried out in two energy ranges, the low energy range and the high energy range. The low energy range going from 0.19 up to 2.93 MeV and devoted to the study of PP, PP and beryllium 7 neutrinos, and the high energy range between 2.3 and 16 MeV devoted to the study of boron 8 and HEP solar neutrinos. This analysis had its fulfillment with the Nature publication in 2018 and also with two other papers published in 2019, where we discussed more in detail the specifics of the two analyses, the two low and high energy region analysis. Let's now move to see how practically we were able to extract the PP chain solar neutrinos fluxes. Well, in this plot, in logarithmic scale, you see the Borexino energy spectrum of the data examined for this study, which were collected in about 1,300 days of data taking, each for an exposed mass of 71.3 tons. The fit range, the energy fit range was roughly from 0.2 up to 3 MeV, as we have for the low energy region targets, PP, PP, and beryllium 7 neutrinos. And this plot showed the data after the software cuts I previously described, that are the removal of muons, the selection of a fiducial volume, and the tagging, as in this case, or subtracting of the carbon 11 background. Solar neutrinos, as I was saying, are just one of the contributions we do expect to have in our region of interest. So in this plot, you can see the predicted Borexino spectral shapes for solar neutrinos in red solid lines and for the main backgrounds and contribution in dashed lines. Background contribution that in the low energy region analysis are mainly the carbon 14, which is an irreducible background in any organic scintillator, the bismuth 210, which comes from the lead 210, and the polonium, its daughter, the polonium 210, again coming from lead 210. Then we have also the krypton 85, which is present in the air due to the fallout of the atmospheric nuclear test in the 60s. And then we have the carbon 11, as I was saying, the main cosmogenic background. Of course, it's not reported in this plot, but we also take into account the pileup of this kind of background events. The data were presented in this analysis as two energy spectra, one with the carbon 11 included and one with the carbon 11 subtracted. These energy spectra were then simultaneously fit. How? Well, we use two complementary fit methods, one exploiting the analytical model of the detector, as was described previously by Alessio. An analytical fit take into account the analytical model of the detector response and, of course, give us the possibility to describe unknown time variation of these parameters. The other method is the Monte Carlo fit, which can exploit the detailed Monte Carlo modeling, which was done on the calibration data, and could count of a supercent accuracy as described in the paper also discussed before by Alessio. The neutrino rates are then extracted by fitting the experimental data with expected spectra of signals and backgrounds. And we perform a multivariate fit and we obtain the neutrino interaction rates by maximizing a Binet likelihood function, which includes several contributions. It combines the contribution coming from the energy spectrum, the fitting of the energy spectrum with the carbon 11, the energy spectrum depleted in carbon 11, Then the pulse shape distribution of the electron and positron, which helps to improve the fit capability to disentangle carbon 11, and of the radial distribution of events, which helps to improve the fit capability to disentangle external backgrounds. Concerning the high energy region analysis, I just want to highlight that the dataset was larger actually of the one used for the low energy region analysis, and it also includes part of the so-called Borecino phase one data. And that the strategy adopted was to perform a Monte Carlo fit to the radial distribution of the events and not to the energy distribution of the events as for the low energy region analysis. This was done in order to separate the external background's contribution from the one of the signal. In this table, you see here summarized that the results obtained by Borecino with this analysis with respect to the previsions taking into account the standard solar model high metallicity or low metallicity hypothesis. I want to stress that the uncertainty of our experimental Beryllium 7 and Boron 8 results is now lower than the theoretical one. Also, what we found was that all rates and fluxes were fully compatible with what we measured before, and also improve what was the uncertainty of our already published results. I move to the conclusion of my talks by considering what are the implications of these measurements, not only the value itself of the solar neutrino fluxes, but also its implications. A first astrophysical implication is the probe of the solar fusion mechanism. We probe the solar fusion mechanism by studying the two primary modes of terminating the PP chain, which are the PP chain 1 and PP chain 2. By measuring this rate, which Borecino found out to be 0.178 plus 0.027 minus 0.023, we could verify that the value was well in agreement with the expectation from the high and low metallicity, and so actually confirm what is the base concept of the standard solar model. A second astrophysical implication concerns the solar luminosity. Using Borecino data only, we can calculate the solar luminosity in neutrinos. And what we found out was that this neutrino solar luminosity was well in agreement with the measurement, the well-measured photon value. This actually confirms the nuclear origin of the solar power and proves that the sun has been in thermodynamic equilibrium over the last 10 to the 5 years. That, as we have seen, is the time required for a photon to flow from the center of the sun to the surface. A third and last astrophysical implications concerns the metallicity puzzle. Combining the Borecino results on Beryllium 7 and Boron 8 in a likelihood ratio test, we obtain a small hint towards the high metallicity scenario. In this plot, you can see the Borecino allowed contour. All contours are expressed at 68.27% confidence level. So in green, the Borecino allowed contour from the Beryllium 7 and Boron neutrino fluxes measurements in the flux beryllium flux boron space. We also show the theoretical prediction for the low metallicity in blue and high metallicity in red scenario, standard solar models. And then you see here the global analysis contour obtained by combining the new Borecino results with old solar and CAMLAN data. This global contour was obtained by leaving free the oscillation parameters and actually retrieving oscillation parameters values well in agreement with what reported in the work by Esteban et al. Of 2017. Again, from this plot, it's quite evident that we are largely dominated by the theoretical standard solar model. Finally, The last implication, we study the new sun with neutrinos, but we can also study neutrinos with the sun. And in this plot, you see the electron survival probability as a function of the energy. The magenta band represents the allowed region by the MSW LMA scenario for the solar neutrino oscillation. The light gray band is the vacuum, the expectation according to the vacuum scenario. And we also report the experimental PEE survival probability evaluated according to the Borexino measurements so far described. Observing any deviation from the MSW LMA scenario, especially here in the transition region of the survival probability, could hint to non-standard physics, as for instance, mass-varying neutrinos or non-standard neutrinos interaction models. What we can currently say is that Borexino data alone disfavor the vacuum hypothesis at 98.2% confidence level. So coming to the real conclusion of my talks, well, solar neutrinos were and still are essential in proving how the sun shines and in discovering the stunning the physics of neutrino oscillations. Borexino is a very unique and powerful experiment, taking data since 2007. And in these 14 years, it was able to map out the entire PP solar fusion chain at very high precision. It was able to probe the solar fusion by studying the two primary modes of terminating of the PP chain. It confirmed the nuclear origin of the solar power. By studying the combination of its Baryon 7 and Boron 8 measurement, could give a slight hint towards the standard solar model high metallicity scenario. Finally, by simultaneously test the electron survival probability both in the vacuum and matter-dominated region, we can actually study and find maybe probes of interesting new physics, as I was saying in the last slide. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Alessandra, for this clear and explicative talk. Are there questions? No, it seems that you were very, very clear. So thank you again, Alessandra. And now we move to the next talk. And since, as I said, Marco had to cancel his talk, and Nicola will be late for some urgent commitment, we move to the talk of Francesco. Implications of PP cycle and CNO cycle neutrino measurements for solar neutrino physics. So please, Francesco, share the screen and you can start. Okay, Francesco, you have to unmute yourself.
I think now you can hear me.
Yes, fine.
Okay. So the goal of this talk is to put the measurement of PP chain neutrino and CNO cycle neutrino in the context of solar physics, even if this was already beautifully done in part by the previous talk. And this talk is prepared in was also presented in collaboration with Aldo Serenelli. Let me go full screen, sorry. Okay. So the sun is peculiar because being so close to us in stellar physics, because being so close to us, it can be observed through a variety of different messengers. No? We can look at the photons which are emitted by the photosphere, the traditional way, but we can also study it by looking at neutrinos which are emitted in its core by nuclear reaction, or by looking at its oscillation through this high-gas seismology. As a result of this, it is very well studied and it provides the benchmark for stellar evolution and also the laboratory for fundamental physics. Now, the theoretical comprehension of the Sun is based on the so-called standard stellar model, which is a solution of stellar structure equation implying a certain chemical evolution paradigm according to which the Sun was born as chemically homogeneous and then it has evolved chemical abundances only due to nuclear reaction and elemental diffusion during its lifetime, which is equal to 4.57 gigayear, and which is based, of course, on the knowledge of the properties of solar plasma, opacity, equation of state, and nuclear perception. Now, the important point is that the unknown quantities, which are the mixing length and the chemical composition of the initial model of the Sun, to define the standard solar model, can be fixed by requiring that the present Sun reproduce its observational properties, namely its radius, its luminosity, and the surface composition of the present Sun, here parametrized in terms of Z over X at the surface. As a result of this, the standard solar model has no free parameters, so it's fully predictive and can be falsified by other observations, like, for example, observation provided by solar neutrino experiment and teleseismology. So the test of standard solar model is really important from the point of view of stellar evolution and stellar physics. This kind of view is particularly important because in recent time, after the solution of the solar neutrino problem, a new problem arises in solar physics, which is called the solar abundance problem. As I explained before, the solar surface composition is a fundamental input to define a standard solar model, and this is determined with spectroscopic technique. Now, starting from early 2000, there was a systematic reanalysis of the abundances of heavy elements at the surface of the Sun, based on improvements like three-dimensional model of the lower atmosphere, et cetera, et cetera, which produced a downward revision of solar abundances. This can be seen in this table where heavy element abundances, these are the elements which are most relevant in standard solar model construction. No, so the abundances of this element are given in this standard logarithmic astronomical scale through time and different authors. The two highlighted composition correspond to the so-called IZ composition and the LOTZ composition, which are often used as a reference to construct a standard solar model, but which that do not exhaust the list of possibilities. No? We also have other determination. The difference in the abundance of the various elements can be quite large, at the level of 20% for carbon and nitrogen, or at the level of 40% for oxygen. So this can produce an important effect on the prediction of for our Sun. Why do we care about metals in the Sun? Because metals, if we change the surface composition of the Sun, since the Sun is nearly homogeneous in metals, we change the entire chemical composition of the Sun, and metals affect the properties of the solar plasma, in particular the opacity of the solar plasma. This is seen in this plot, from which we see that at the center of the Sun, in the energy producing region, metal account for about 50% of the total opacity, with important contribution provided mainly by iron. They are even more relevant in the external radiative region, at close to the convective boundary. The Sun has an external convective envelope, where they account for about 80% of the total, with relevant contribution from several elements like oxygen, silicon, iron, neon, etc. Now, opacity is the parameter which controls the efficiency of radiative energy transfer, so which basically determines the temperature stratification in the Sun. So if we change the composition, we change the opacity of the plasma, and we change the temperature stratification, a more metallic Sun is a Sun with a larger central temperature. And this gives us observable consequences. In addition to this, the carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen nuclei are also important within the CNO cycle for hydrogen fusion, and so they control the efficiency of CNO cycle, and this is an important point which will be better discussed in the following. Now, the solar abundance problem is the fact that the downward revision of the heavy element photospheric abundances, which has been obtained with new spectroscopic measurement, leads to standard solar model which do not reproduce heliosismic observables. This is seen in this table and in this plot, where I show, for example, the prediction which are obtained by standard solar model implementing the IZ old composition and the LOZ new, in principle improved surface composition, with the value of this quantity, which can be inferred by LSSmology, by studying the seismic properties of the sun. In particular, here we have the surface helium abundance and the inner envelope of the convective envelope, so the depth of the convective zone. And we see that models implementing the new composition fail to reproduce the seismic data, and we have a 2-3 sigma discrepancies. We also see in the above plot the situation with the sound speed. We give the difference, in particular, is shown the fractional difference between the sound speed profile as a function of the solar radius inferred from the seismic frequencies with respect to the sound speed predicted by the model. And we see that models, so standard solar model implementing the whole composition, reproduce much better the observational result with respect to models with the new composition. Okay, so the solar abundance problem basically tells us that there is something wrong or unaccounted in our models of the sun. And here is a schematic, very schematic list of possibilities to explain this problem. It could be, for example, that the new abundances, despite being improved with respect to the old one, are not sufficiently accurate to give us the correct value of metallicity of the sun. If this is the case, this has implication for the entire field of stellar astrophysics, because solar abundances are also used as a reference for other stars. Or it could be that the opacity of solar plasma is not correctly described. It has been advocated that non-standard effect, like, for example, dark matter accumulation in the solar core, could alleviate the solar abundance problem, even if a solution has not been found. Or the most intriguing possibility is that the evolution of the sun, the chemical evolution paradigm employed in the standard solar model, is oversimplified, or something peculiar happened to the sun with respect to other stars. And this kind of discussion was also touched by Vic Axton in his talk the day before yesterday. But let me emphasize that we are really testing our understanding of the sun. So it's a real problem with potential implication, important implication for the field of stellar astrophysics and or fundamental physics. There have been some progresses in recent times, both in the determination of the photospheric composition. In particular, Asplund has provided in this year a reanalysis of the solar abundances of long-lived elements at the surface of the sun, but this analysis confirmed the low solar abundances of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen obtained in previous studies. These are the results. And in the table, we also have a comparison with the previous solar abundance determination. The plot shows the Asplund result. The oxygen abundance have been also reanalyzed in a very recent paper by Berkeman and collaborator. They found a slightly larger value than Asplund. The two determinations are consistent in reality within the errors. So the origin of the small difference seems to be understood systematically and understood is related to the analyzed data and the model which have been considered. Anyhow, this kind of increase is not sufficient to explain the discrepancy with heliosismology, so the solar abundance problem remains intact and still has to be solved. Also, opacity has been measured, in particular iron opacity in this paper, has been measured in conditions similar to the condition in the interior of the sun. And data here are shown by the black line are compared with the prediction of different models, and we see that there is a large discrepancy. You know, the models have narrower lines, a lower Casey continuum, also deeper opacity windows, so the difference for iron could be quite large. However, when this kind of difference is integrated of all the possible wavelength and also is diluted to take into account that we have several different elements in the sun, it corresponded to a moderate increase of the opacity, which is not sufficient to explain the problem. Further experiments with regarding the opacity have been done with different elements, chromium and nickel. Some of the problems which were seen for the iron case were present also with these elements. Others were not observed, suggesting that the ingredient missing in the model could have a non-trivial dependence on the charge of the considered element. Now, in this context, we could ask ourselves what neutrinos tell us. We know that neutrinos are produced in the sun as a consequence of hydrogen burning. Indeed, the overall effect of hydrogen burning is the conversion of four protons and two electrons to form one helium-4 nucleus. For each helium-4 nucleus which is produced in the plasma, a given amount of energy is emitted in the plasma and two electron neutrinos which have to be present in order to guarantee charge and electron number conservation. Then neutrino free stream and reach us in 8 minutes, providing us with direct information on the energy producing region of the sun. As we know, there are two main mechanisms for hydrogen fusion, the PP chain, which has been discussed before, and the CNO cycle, which uses carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen nuclei, which are present in the core of the sun, as catalysts for hydrogen fusion. CNO cycle is subdominant in the sun, is responsible for 1% of the total neutrino and energy budget, but it's a fundamental process in stellar astrophysics because it is the dominant mechanism in more massive star or in star in a more advanced evolutionary stage than our sun. The solar neutrino spectrum, which is produced, calculated according to standard solar model, is shown here. The black line corresponds to the components of the flux produced within the PP cycle, while the blue and red lines are the components produced in the CNO cycle. These are the conventional CNO neutrinos produced by the beta decay of nitrogen 13, oxygen 15, and fluorine 17, while the red lines correspond to the monochromatic electron capture CNO neutrinos produced by electron capture reaction on the same element. Very schematically, the horizontal bars show the range which have been probed by the different solar neutrino experiments during the last 40 years. The situation prior to the last Borrexian result is summarized in this table, where I compare the prediction of standard solar model with IZ composition and log Z composition with the value of the different component of the flux, which can be inferred by fitting the data of solar neutrino experiment in the assumption of a flavor oscillation of neutrinos. As we heard from the previous talk, beryllium and boron 8 neutrino components are determined experimentally with high accuracy, with a few percent uncertainties due to SNOW, supercamucanda, and borexino, and this uncertainty is smaller than uncertainty in theoretical prediction. Here in this table, we have a determination of the PP and PP neutrino flux at the percent level, which, however, is not a direct measure. The first direct measure of PP neutrino flux has been provided by Borrexino, as we heard from the previous talk. And this is very important. It represents a milestone because this is the dominant component of the neutrino flux. And its direct determination allows us to test energy source and the energy balance of the sun and also the solar stability. This is better explained in this slide. If we assume indeed that the sun is stable, you know, we have that the total energy which is emitted at the surface of the sun through radiative processes or by neutrino emission and or by hypothetical additional exotic energy losses, for example, new particles which are produced and then emitted to the surface of the sun, should match the total amount of energy which is produced in the solar interior by nuclear reaction and by gravothermal energy production mechanism. which are related to variation of the internal energy and the gravitational energy of the sun. This term is negligible, it's at the level of 10 to the minus 4 of the total luminosity, so we have a connection between luminosity and the total energy which is produced in the sun by nuclear reaction. Now, the neutrino luminosity can be expressed as a function of the neutrino fluxes, which are detected at Earth, but also the total amount of energy can be connected with the fluxes which are determined, because there is a strict connection between neutrino emission and energy release. No? For each neutrino, a given amount of energy is released globally in the plasma, as I explained before. So we arrive at the following expression, which connect the total amount of energy which is radiated at the surface of the sun with the neutrino fluxes which are measured at Earth. This relationship may seem trivial, but it is not, because while neutrino free stream and reach us in 8 minutes, the energy which is emitted at the surface has been produced at the center of the sun and then slowly diffused over a time scale of the order of 10 to the 5 year. No, so we are allowed to have this kind to postulate this equality only if we assume that the sun is stable. So this is a test of solar stability, and the possibility to test this the validity of this is strictly related to the possibility of measuring the neutrino fluxes, and in particular the pp neutrino fluxes. And in addition to this, by checking the validity of this equality, we can test the global energy balance of the sun and constrain additional energy losses or energy sources by exotic mechanisms in the sun. Beryllium and boron neutrino fluxes have been determined, as we said, with very high accuracy. And it can be used as a solar thermometer to infer the central temperature of the sun. Indeed, these fluxes depend, as it is written in this relationship, by a high power of the central temperature of the sun, and they also depend on the cross-section of the nuclear reaction with controlled branching between the different termination of the pp chain. So we have this kind of relationship. In this plot, I compare the central value for in the plane beryllium boron of the fluxes which are predicted in standard solar modeling implementing IZ and LZ composition with the observational inferred result, observational inferred results. Now, since these models are calculated by assuming the same input for nuclear reaction cross-section, the difference in the two models only arises from a difference in the temperature, and the temperature central temperature of solar model with the IZ composition and LZ composition differ by an amount which is smaller than 1%. So we understand that the determination of these fluxes can be used to constrain the temperature, the central temperature of the sun at a very high level, with very high precision. In principle, the observational data are sufficiently accurate even to discriminate between the prediction obtained by assuming the two different compositions. However, theoretical uncertainties dominate the error budget. These are due to the assumed surface composition, to the error in the surface composition, but also to environmental parameter, in particular the opacity, and to nuclear cross section. And so the situation is the following, and we see that at the moment, no, theoretical uncertainties are not sufficiently small, in particular due to the composition of opacity degeneracy, to the fact that, that there is a degeneracy between these two quantities, are not sufficiently accurate to discriminate the chemical composition of the sun. So the conclusion is that beryllium-7 and boron-8 neutrino well constrain the central temperature of the sun, but do not determine the core composition with sufficient accuracy. The situation is different when we consider CNO neutrinos, because CNO neutrinos are produced within the CNO cycle. And the CNO cycle use carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen nuclei, which are present in the core of the sun, to produce hydrogen fusion. In reality, in the sun, the only one branch of the CNOB cycle is complete, the CN branch. And the efficiency of this CN branch depends on the bottleneck reaction, which is this one, the nitrogen 14 plus proton into oxygen 15 plus gamma. The rate of this reaction determines the efficiency of the cycle and thus it also determines the total amount of neutrinos which are produced within this cycle, the nitrogen 13 and the oxygen 15 neutrino. The rate of this reaction depends on the central temperature of the sun, on the cross-section of this reaction, but it also depends on the total amount of nitrogen which is present in the core of the sun. And the distribution of CNO element in the sun is shown in this plot here. No? We see that in the central region of the sun, where the CNO cycle is most effective, is complete, all carbon which was originally available has been converted into nitrogen. And so the total amount of nitrogen in the core is equal to the total carbon plus nitrogen metallicity of the solar core. So at the end, we expect that beside being dependent on temperature and nuclear cross-section, the two oxygen 15 and nitrogen 15 fluxes are also dependent, directly proportional in particular, to the metallicity of the solar core, in particular to the carbon and nitrogen content of the solar core. This extra dependence can be used to extract the chemical composition of the core. This was an idea which was originally considered in this paper, and then it was applied to the Borexino measurement in this other publication. Borexino is measuring a combination of the oxygen 15 and nitrogen 13 neutrino fluxes, which is given here. So we can combine the Borexino rate for CNO neutrinos with the precise determination, for example, of the boron neutrino flux, which is used as a solar thermometer, to eliminate, you know, in this previous relation, the dependence on the temperature, you know, obtaining in this way a direct determination of the metallicity of the solar core with a residual uncertainties, which is very small, and which is dominated by the uncertainties in the nuclear cross-section, in particular in the S114 cross-section. The level of accuracy that we have to reach depends on what we want to know. If we want to probe the difference between IZ and log Z, then we have to consider that the fluxes, the oxygen 15 and the CNO fluxes differ by about 140% in the two models. So we have to be to measure the rate in Borexino better than this. If we want to constrain, for example, elemental diffusion, then we have to be much better and to reach a better precision. Borexino has a sieved measurement of the CNO neutrino signal. It is a very important result, which proves for the first time the efficiency of the CNO cycle in the sun. The absence of CNO neutrino signal is described as 5 sigma. The rate which has been obtained favors the IZ composition because it's relatively high with respect to the prediction of standard solar model. However, the accuracy is still not sufficiently good in order to discriminate the composition. This is also seen in this plot where in this bubble, no, the prediction of model implementing a different surface composition of the sun are compared with the observational data. The band corresponds to the experimental uncertainty. So we see that model implementing the old composition are favored, but the error does not allow us to exclude the other. In the future, we may hope to have a progress. It will be very important. Borexino is still analyzing data, but we also have planet detector, in particular here is there is a list, which could improve our knowledge of the solar neutrino fluxes and in particular of the CNO neutrinos, so with the hope to obtain important information for the solution of the solar neutrino problem. In this respect, let me remind that there are also some minor components of the solar neutrino flux which are still undetected, in particular the HP neutrinos and the electron capture CNO neutrino. So there is still work for the future. So I came to my conclusion. Solar neutrino physics is entering the precision era. Solar neutrino provide us with a detailed knowledge of the solar core, and they can constrain standard and non-standard energy generation and transfer mechanism, and also the solar chemical evolution paradigm. To exploit, however, the full potential of future measurement, we need improvement also in the standard solar model constitutive physics, in particular at the level of radiative opacity and nuclear cross-section. But we may hope that future CNO neutrino measurement could solve some unsolved puzzle, like, for example, the solar abundance problem in the next future. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Francesco, for this clear talk. And thank you to point that the job is not yet completed, so we have still other very challenging measurements for the future. Questions?
I have a question somehow related to this topic. Do we know the influence of the magnetic field of the sun through these solar models?
The audio was not very good, but if I got correctly, you are asking about magnetic field. In this standard solar model, do not are spherically symmetric, perfectly spherically symmetric standard solar model which are calculated, and do not have effects, do not include effects which are related to the magnetic field. These effects are expected to be small, however. also, the in principle, also the deviation from isotropy of the sun can be constrained by aerosismic observation. And so there is so you can check that this approximation is adequate. If the problem persists anyhow, then one has to try a solution. In this sense, all kind of effect which could alter the chemical composition have to be taken into account. No, I don't know, I'm thinking about the possibility of extra mixing or accretion of material with different composition and all these kind of things. No, for example, in Vic Axton talk, it was discussed the possibility that this the devolution of the sun could be with respect to the simple model which is employed in standard solar model. I mean, the chemical evolution could be peculiar because one is in a planetary system, and in the formation of this planetary system, the sun at different stage of its evolution could accrete matter with different chemical composition with respect to the composition of the primordial nebula. No, this is a very intriguing possibility, which in principle can be tested by very accurate solar neutrino CNO measurement, but which for the moment is at the level of an hypothesis.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there other questions? No. So thank you, Francesco. We can move to the next talk, which is at this point the talk of Aldo Ianni, about the role of a CNO cycle in massive stars. So please, Aldo, share the screen and you can start. I see the time.
Okay, yes. No, I'm here, Gioacchino. Thank you. I'm okay. Sharing my screen. Just a moment. Veloce. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes, Aldo, yes.
Okay, thank you. Well, okay. I don't know. Something wrong.
It's okay. It's okay. It's a full screen.
Yeah, no, I tried to... Ah, here it is. Okay. To open the camera. Okay, so I'm discussing a little bit in a different perspective the role of the CNO in STARS in the light of what has been measured by Borexino. So as was said, this is the fundamental paradigm of the energy production in the sun, and goes through hydrogen burning through two mechanisms. One is the PP chain and the other one is the CNO cycle. And as Francesco highlighted, it's mainly the CN cycle of the bicycle. So the PP chain is primarily at work in small mass solar-like stars, and in particular in the first generation stars, where the core of the star is mainly consists mainly of hydrogen, while in second and third generation stars, there could be some, as a matter of fact, there are some heavier elements such as carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and so on, which can start the other cycle. So this idea was introduced independently between 1937 and 1939 by von Weizsäcker and Beze, who understood that carbon could trigger a different hydrogen burning with respect to the proton-proton burning. And as a matter of fact, this was thought to be the dominant energy source in STAR. How this works? As has been already highlighted, there are a number of interactions, and P-gamma interactions, or beta decay, or P-alpha interaction, which can, starting from carbon, for example, one can start also from nitrogen. Starting from carbon produces nitrogen, then nitrogen an electron neutrino, and then nitrogen 14, and nitrogen oxygen. And then at that point, there are two possibilities one can reproduce the carbon to start again over and over this process. And this gives rise to the CN cycle, which in the end, what it does is only consumes hydrogen, but not carbon or the other nuclei. Consuming hydrogen and producing the same amount of energy that is produced in the PP chain. But what can happen is that instead of P alpha interaction, you can have a P gamma interaction. And so at that point, you can produce oxygen 16, and the cycle branches to a different, a second cycle, which in the sun it's a lower probability cycle. And as was highlighted, but Francesco previously, the slowest reaction due to also the highest Coulomb barrier is the P gamma on nitrogen 14, and which drives the time scale of this cycle producing energy. And in addition, it was still 1950, this was considered, the CN cycle was considered the primary energy source. And because of that, a number of measurements on cross sections for the involved nuclear processes and electromagnetic captures was undertaken. And In the end, it was understood that this is not a dominant cycle, as a matter of fact, in a star like the Sun, with a temperature of the order of 1 kV in the core. And it was also understood that beyond the CN, so-called cold cycle, there are other cycles. And this is what I want to discuss. In order to discuss and understand the physics behind this, one has to take into account the stellar interaction rates, how they work, and what are the main parameters involved in the in these interaction rates. So as one can say, the main parameters are the temperature of the star, which gives it's essentially is essentially the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution of velocities of particles interacting inside the core of the star, and the probability to go through the Coulomb barrier. And coupling these together, one can determine the interaction cross-section, and from the interaction cross-section, the time scale of the different processes. So the point that one has to take into account is that determining the interaction cross-section below 100 kV and taking into account that the Sun is a 1 kV, it's very difficult from an experimental point of view. And it's mainly based, with very few exceptions, on extrapolation from high energy. So there are uncertainties in this extrapolation mechanism. But in any case, what matters here is essentially is the cross-section asymptotically going to zero energy, interaction energy, and other parameters such as the temperature of the star inside the star and so on. So from these interaction rates, one can, for example, determine the order of magnitude of time scale for the P gamma interaction on carbon and nitrogen, as highlighted here at the solar core temperature. So the solar standard model gives a satisfactory account of these processes and on a number of parameters that have been and will be discussed in this section. But in particular, what I think is very important is that the CNO cycle in this in the Sun gives only a contribution, minor contribution of the order of 1% to the energy production, mainly driven by the CN cold cycle. So this 1% is a small amount in the overall contribution, and it's an important result that Borexino, has been highlighted by Alessandra previously, has confirmed this picture, namely that the CNO gives a contribution of the other 1%. So showing that, as a matter of fact, this mechanism is at work. And this mechanism is dominant in more massive stars. So what happens when the capture on nitrogen branches producing oxygen? So in that case, oxygen produces fluor and oxygen 17. So then the cycle can go back to nitrogen 14 or can even produce fluor 18. So this second cycle is not dominant, as we have said, in producing energy, but it's important in producing heavier elements. So in the nucleosynthesis of other elements, oxygen, fluor inside the Sun, it's important. And it's also important to trigger other CNO cycles. So in the end, what happens is the following, is that what is, has been shown in this slide, that you have a main CN cycle, so-called the cold CNO cycle, which is producing this 1% of energy. driven by the time scale of the capture on nitrogen 14. And then with a probability of the order of 1/1000, you branch to produce oxygen 16, and giving rise to a second cycle. But what happens is that this second cycle can also produce other cycles, as I will try to explain. And also there are some even extreme behavior when the temperature goes above 10^8 Kelvin, and also when the star also leaves the main sequence population. And for example, there could be the possibility that a P gamma interaction on nitrogen 13 works faster than the beta decay of nitrogen 13. So in that case, as you can see, you produce oxygen 14, which then decays back to nitrogen 14, re-feeding the CN cycle. So the same anomalous behavior can happen to fluor 17 at high temperature, which can produce a neon 18. So this mechanism can produce, as you can say, some anomaly in the development of the standard CNO cycle, and producing even a further boost to the nucleosynthesis of elements. So as we have said, the two cycles, the CNO cycle and PPED2 mechanism, they work very differently in as a function of the temperature. And this also is related to the interaction processes and also to the strength of the Coulomb barrier in the different interactions. And the dependence of the CNO cycle on the energy production is much stronger. It's much stronger. But and this is for this reason, in larger stars than the Sun, it's a dominant energy production process through hydrogen burning. So this is something that I'm not discussing, but just to show you that the mechanism to understand that this CNO energy production is at work has been experimentally proven studying the neutrinos, solar neutrinos. And these are the results from Borexino, which in spite of some important accuracy achieved in beryllium and boro neutrinos is not able to disentangle, as has been discussed, between the high metallicity and low metallicity. And this is a fundamental problem which can be solved looking at the CNO neutrinos in more detail from an experimental point of view. And as was pointed out in previous sections by Aldo Serenelli, a 10% measurement of the CNO neutrino would be very valuable to disentangle the high to low metallicity, because in spite of the accuracy at the level of 3% of beryllium and boro neutrinos, as it is shown in this slide, it is impossible to disentangle the high and low metallicity due to uncertainties in the solar standard model. So coming back to the role of CNO neutrinos, as I previously pointed out, a very important output of the Borexino measurement, in spite of the low accuracy of the present result, is the fact that the measurement is in agreement with what predicted by the standard solar model, or namely that the CNO is producing in the Sun about 1% of the energy. So this is a fundamental result, and in particular for proving the existence of the CNO cycle. So coming back to the cycle itself, there could be additional cycles and how this works. So the in the standard cycle, as you, if you look at this standard CNO or canonical CNO cycle, you can produce the oxygen 17, and the oxygen 17 can branch to a P gamma or P alpha interaction. And in the case of a P alpha P gamma interaction, can produce fluor 18. So this fluor 18 starts a new cycle, and it has been shown already in 1974 that the ratio between the P alpha and P gamma interaction is about one in specific energy ranges. And this is mainly related to the fact that the P alpha interaction has a resonance, important resonance at 66 kV. And so this fact essentially tells that the CNO cycle is tricycling. And what happens is the following, that the oxygen 17 branches producing oxygen 18, which gives rise to this third so-called cycle that from oxygen 18 through a P alpha interaction re-feed the previous cycle producing nitrogen 15. But as you can already see from this picture, there could be even a fourth cycle starting from oxygen 18. And this fourth cycle, it's a very low probability because you need a very high energy. And as a matter of fact, the ratio between the P alpha and P gamma interaction on oxygen 18 is always greater than 100 with a flat minimum where it's of the order 100 between 10 to the 9 and 7 times 10 to the 9 Kelvin. So very high temperature with respect to the solar temperature. So in this case, in this energy region, with a probability of 1%, you can develop a fourth cycle, which is this one, producing fluor 19. So the fluor 19 eventually can also produce neon, and this can stop the catalytic cycle, not feeding back the previous one, as highlighted in this slide. So, and the neon at that point will start a new energy production cycle, so-called the neon sodium. So another consideration we can make on the role of the CNO cycle is based on the mass luminosity relation for stars. So if one look at the population of main sequence stars, one can roughly say that there is a power law between the luminosity and the mass. In a wide range of star masses. And this power law also defines that the lifetime of stars, because this relationship implies that the lifetime scales as m to the power of minus 2.5. So in that case, one can determine that a star with 10 times the solar mass will last about 1,000 times, three order of magnitude less. So with respect to a star with the one solar mass. So this implies that a heavy solar heavy star burns the fuel much faster. And if you, and then this can be used to determine the fraction of energy consumed by the CNO cycle. So if one looks at this mass luminosity relationship in more detail, one can appreciate that as a matter of fact, in small bins, the power law can change. And for example, between 1 and 10 solar masses, the power law has a coefficient of 4. Smaller masses, it's a smaller coefficient, and so on. Overall, it's well approximated by about 3.5, but there are small differences. So one can take into account these small differences. And coupling that information with the star's number density, which scales also as a power law, but with a minus sign, then it's possible to understand that the larger mass stars are less abundant than small mass stars. The small mass star and all the large mass star burn much faster. And coupling all this information together, one can determine this ratio, which is the energy produced by a small mass star, namely the star which are burning hydrogen through PP chain, and stars where the hydrogen is burned by the CNO, mainly by the CNO cycle. And this number is much less than one, implying that in the production of energy of burning hydrogen burning stars, the CNO cycle is really a dominant cycle mechanism. So in conclusion, I told you that the CNO cycle is a crucial mechanism in stars, very important, that it's a dominant in the energy production in the range of less than 10 solar masses stars. The Borexino has shown that this cycle, in particular the CN called the cycle, is at work, which implies also that all we have said about more massive stars should be correct. And as highlighted also by other speakers, CNO neutrino observation could shed light on solar abundance problem, hopefully through future measurements and analysis of the collected data. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Aldo, for this clear talk. Questions for Aldo? No, so it was extremely clear. Thank you, Aldo, again. And we move now
thank you.
To Sandra. That which we talk about study of antineutrino from the cosmos from the Earth.
Fine. Okay.
Sandra.
So I'll try to share my screen. So let's see. Okay. Now, okay. Now I close this panel. Okay. Is it fine?
Fine, please go ahead.
Okay, I thank the organizer for inviting me to give this talk. In particular, I would like to present the study of Borexino about antineutrinos from the cosmos and from the Earth. So in my talk, first of all, I will describe the large variety of antineutrino sources and how we can detect them with liquid scintillator. Then in particular, I will present the Borexino studies about the geoneutrino and about the diffuse supernova neutrino background. And I will conclude with the perspectives. Well, astrophysical neutrino covers at least 18 order of magnitude in energy, starting from 1000 electron volt to 20 electron volt. And in particular, electron antineutrinos have been emitted during the BBN by the neutron and tritium decays, and are continuously emitted by our planet in the decay of the uranium, thorium, and potassium isotopes that are enclosed in the rocks of the crust and of the mantle. Going to higher energy, we found the reactor antineutrinos. And then mixed sources of both neutrino and antineutrinos are the relic one, the solar thermal neutrino. You can see here the emitting reaction, Bestrahlung, Compton, and plasma decay processes, but as you can see, emit an equal amount of antineutrinos and of neutrinos. And going to higher energy, we find the diffuse supernova neutrino background, atmospheric neutrinos, up to very, very high energy, where we have sources from galactic and extragalactic origins, such as active galactic nuclei, gamma ray bursts, or star-forming galaxies. Now, in the energy range of interest for the Borexino studies, we can detect antineutrinos through the elastic scattering. This process has no threshold, is sensitive to all flavors, but the cross-section for neutrinos and antineutrinos are a factor five, six higher respect to the one for the muonic and tauonic flavor. And the reason is the contribution of the charged current interaction term. Here you can see from this panel the cross-section for electroneutrino and antineutrinos, but for this last particle we have a very promising channel, which is the inverse beta decay, but as you can see has a factor 100 higher cross-section. And in the inverse beta decay, the electron-antineutrinos interact with a proton, giving a neutron and a positron. The positron immediately annihilates, giving a prompt release of energy, while the neutron thermalizes and then it is captured by a proton, giving a characteristic capture gamma. And you see that in general, there is an important feature in the sense that the prompt energy is strictly related to the energy of the incoming antineutrinos. Therefore, it is possible to reconstruct the energy of the antineutrinos that gave the interaction. And the only drawback is represented by the fact that this channel has a threshold of 1.8 MeV. Now you have already heard about the Borexino detector performances in the previous talk. I want just to remind that we have two DIACO systems, the main one called the LABEN that has been developed for solar neutrino physics, and it provides good linearity up to few MeV, especially for events far from the center. And so we have a second acquisition system that has been developed for higher energy up to 50 megaelectron volt, and it consists of 96 fast waveform digitizers, so-called flash ADC systems. And so for the search of astrophysical antineutrinos, we have combined both the system. So let me start from the Borexino study about geoneutrinos. Well, from measurement of the temperature gradient along the whole planet, we know that our planet is emitted a fixed amount of heat, which is equal to 47 terawatt plus minus 2. And the point is that where is all this energy coming from? And there are two main important sources. The first is the secular cooling, and the second are the radioactive decays. In fact, in the rocks, there are uranium, thorium, and potassium that provides a sizable amount of heat. But the relative importance of these two contributions indeed is not at all known. For example, here are shown the prediction for a particular class of geological models, so-called bulk silicate earth models. And as you can see, there are differences up a factor 3 for what concerns the total radiogenic heat, and the differences become larger as a factor 10 for the, in particular for the contribution from the mantle. And the differences between this model practically is the choice of the particular meteorite that has been adopted as a representative of the composition of the primeval solar nebula. The cosmochemical model chosen in statin chondrites, the geochemical, the carbonaceous chondrites, while the geophysical model introduce also consideration about the amount of energy necessary to support the mantle convection. But we have a fundamental problem to understand, which is the contribution of this radiogenic heat, and they are the geoneutrinos. As you can see, in the decays of uranium, thorium, and potassium are emitted electron antineutrinos. And so if we measure the geoneutrino fluxes, we can reconstruct the producing element abundances, and therefore we can understand the Earth energetics. It is important to underline that in order to perform a complete study are necessary multi-site measurements, because both the signal from the crust and from the mantle in principle is not supposed to be homogeneous. So we need to perform a sort of tomography. Here on the left are shown here in this panel the spectra, the energy spectra of geoneutrinos, and since the inverse beta decay is a threshold of 1.8 MeV, we can detect only the uranium-238 and thorium-242. Geoneutrinos. And also considering the energy dependence on the inverse beta decay cross section, here on the right, you find the expected signal in the detector. And as you can see, the thorium and uranium geoneutrinos show different endpoints. So, in principle, making a spectral analysis of detective event is also possible to distinguish these two contributions. Geoneutrinos has been studied by the Borexino and Camland experiment. Here you find the more recent results. And in particular, for what concerns Camland, I also refer you to the talk, but the beautiful talk that was given on Tuesday by Tadao Mitsui. And I will present in the following the last result from Borexino. Well, how much geoneutrinos do we expect to observe in Gran Sasso, which is the flux? Well, it is very important to determine the contribution coming from the rocks that surround the detectors, I mean, from an area more or less of 400 kilometers of size, because this is responsible for 40% of the signal, of course, because of proximity. And precise models have been developed also based on directly rock sampling. And we think that from this part of the crust, we should detect 9.2 TNU. What is TNU? TNU is a means terrestrial neutrino units. It is a peculiar unit that we use in this field, and it corresponds to one event over 132 target protons, that practically is the amount of proton that is contained in 1 kiloton of liquid scintillator. And per year with 100% efficiency. So this is practically is the number of events that you expect to observe in 1 year for a mass of 1 kiloton detector of liquid scintillator. And so the contribution from the local cluster is known with some precision. And the same is true also for what concerns what is coming from the rest of the crust and the uppermost part of the mantle, the so-called far field lithosphere. And this contribution amounts to 16.7 plus 3.8 minus 3.1 TNU. And the sum of the two is called bulk lithosphere. So from the bulk lithosphere, which is the crust and the uppermost part of the mantle, we expect to observe 25.9 TNU. While the contribution from the mantle is strongly model dependent, and indeed practically it is not at all known. And so this is the goal of our studies. Here you can find the analysis cuts and the selected events. I have no time to go into the detail, just I want to underline that respect to the 2015 analysis, we have enlarged the fiducial volume. During this analysis, we just applied a cut of 10 centimeters from the vessel, and so we increased the exposure, also by improving the cosmogenic cut. Now we have only a 2.2% loss of exposure due to this cut, but in any case, this is extremely important because if the Borexino detector is underground, there is still a sizable amount of muons that can produce cosmogenic nuclides. Here you can see on the right the charge distribution of the prompt event, and here the one of the delayed candidates, and you can clearly recognize the capture peak of neutron on proton and on carbon 12. Here is shown the distance of the events from the vessel, and it is perfectly coherent to what we expect from our Monte Carlo code. So this means that there is no excess at large radius that could be an evidence for a background, external background. And for what concerns the background, the most important contribution are the reactor antineutrinos, and we have developed a precise code to evaluate this contribution at Gran Sasso. We are in contact with the International Atomic Agency that provide us on a monthly basis the thermal powers for each reactor power plant all around the world. And we can compute the spectrum at Gran Sasso and the flux. And in general, the most important source of uncertainty is represented by the emission spectra at the source, because there are reference spectra from Muller et al. 2011, but the reactor antineutrino experiment put in evidence that the measured fluxes are smaller and also has a different shape around 5 MeV. So in order to understand which is the impact of this uncertainty on our analysis, we have computed the detected signal considering both of these cases. And as you can see, there is a difference of 6%. So we expect in our 154 sample, 97.6 event according to Muller or 91.9 from the reactor antineutrino spectra. And so, but as we will see, this is not causing a large uncertainty in the final result. Another important background are the atmospheric neutrinos that can give both charge and current and neutral current interaction with the carbon and hydrogen atoms constituting borexino scintillator, and they could give several reactions that could mimic the inverse beta decay. We have developed the simulations taking the onda and fluke atmospheric neutrino fluxes and simulating, of course, the response of our detector with the inverse beta decay cut. And in the sample of 154 candidate, we estimated 9.2 should be due to atmospheric neutrino with 50% error. Now, the last contribution to background is represented by all the contaminant that in principle could mimic the inverse beta decay reaction. For example, accidental coincidences, alpine reactions such as carbon 14 alpha N, or cosmogenic background like lithium 9 and indium 8 that can give beta plus neutral decays. And so we estimated with great accuracy all these sources of background, but as you can see, the sum of all these possible sources, you can find the detail in this table, amount to only 8 events. So it's more than a factor 10 smaller respect to the reactor antineutrino background. So in order to disentangle the contribution due to the geoneutrino signal, we have performed a spectral fit of the prompt chart of the selected events. And we are in this particular fit, we have fixed all the background to the values from expectation within the error, and we have just leave free the contribution from the reactor antineutrinos. And the fit attributed 52.6 events to geoneutrinos that corresponds to 47 TNU. And so we have achieved a precision of 18%. As you can see here, the evidence for the signal is now very, very, very large. And the particular, we, as I told, we left free the contribution from reactor antineutrinos, but as you can see, what the fit is returning values that are perfectly compatible to what has been computed according to our dedicated code that considers the information provided by the International Atomic Agency. So you see, this is perfectly coherent with expectation. These are these vertical bands and expectation. For what concerns the systematic error budget, you can see that indeed atmospheric neutrino and the shape of reactor spectrum practically contribute in a negligible way to the total budget, while the most important source of systematic uncertainty are the estimation of deficiency and in particular the position reconstruction. Well, but as I highlighted in my introduction, the real goal of this study is the contribution from mantle geoneutrinos. And so in order to understand this, we have repeated the fit by explicit introducing the contribution from the bulk lithosphere and the one from the mantle. But the contribution from the bulk lithosphere is known. It is the 25.7 TNU, I explained my in the first very first slide. And this contribution corresponds to 28.8 events in this in our samples. So we have repeated the fit considering these two contributions. And so the fit finally attribute to the mantle geoneutrino 23.7 events that correspond to 21.2 TNU. And so we can compare with result with the expectation according to the different geological model. And as you can see, our average signal correspond to the more or less to the prediction of the geodynamical model. Of course, the error bar is large, but in any case, at least at the level of 2.4 sigma, we have a tension with the prediction of the cosmochemical model. You can see it there. Okay, and so also what we have done has been to translate our measured signal into a radiogenic heat from uranium and thorium, and to understand how to do it is important to consider also the distribution of uranium and thorium inside the Earth, because of course this is not at all known, and we can take two extreme, let's say, hypotheses, that the mantle is homogeneous, or that all the uranium and thorium are placed at the core mantle boundary, which is the largest distance from the surface or from the detector. And so if also we consider the uncertainty due to this distribution, we can translate our measured signal into a radiogenic heat amount of 24.6 plus minus 11 terawatt. And if we sum up this contribution, this contribution with the from uranium thorium with the one coming from the lithosphere that is known for directly rock studies, with the contribution coming from potassium 40, which is assumed to be 18%, the mantle contribution, we can estimate total radiogenic heat according to the Borexino measurement equal to 38.2 terawatt. And it is represented here. Okay, which is the meaning of this plot? We know that the Earth is emitting 47 plus minus 2 terawatt, and it is this band. And if you consider, for example, this model, this geochemical model from Jahoua, there are 8 terawatt produced by the lithosphere. This is the same because it is what it is directly determined from studies of the rocks. Jahoua estimate 3,000 terawatt from the mantle, this part in orange. And so the rest should be the contribution from secular cooling, that it is highlighted in blue. And moving the scalars, you can see the difference, the relative amount according to the different geological model. And as you can see, the result of Borexino here represented, it's more compatible with the model, this one by Turcotte and Schubert, which is a geodynamical model. So we can conclude saying that Borexin estimates a high probability that the radioactive decays produce more than half of the total Earth heat. So that's all for the moment for what concerns the neutrino. I want just to say a few words about another Borexino study, the one on diffuse supernova neutrino background. Well, the diffuse supernova neutrino background is formed by the hole of the star that collapsed during the evolution of the universe. And it consists both of neutrino and antineutrinos of all the flavors. And if you want to estimate the signal at the heart, we need to know the emission spectra and the supernova rate at a given redshift Z. In general, there is no unique model to estimate the signal we choose as example to model, the one from Nakazato and the one from Udepol. And you can see here the expected fluxes. As you can see, they are extremely small. And so large underground detectors are particularly suited to study this background of neutrinos. We choose as the detection channel the inverse beta decay. So the analysis cut that we have done are similar to the one of the geoneutrino analysis, but we choose a more conservative fiducial volume cut in this case, so a smaller fiducial volume. We asked for a distance of 25 centimeters from the vessel, and also we applied a stronger cosmogenic cut. In order to get conservative limit on the diffuse supernova neutrino background, we considered the minimal expected number of events for each source of background. So for what concerns the contribution from geoneutrino, we have considered only the contribution coming from the crust, the 25.7 TNU. And for what concerns the reactor antineutrino flux, we took the result normalizing the fluxes to the reactor antineutrino experiment because they provide the lower signal. And so here you can find, we selected the statistic up to October 2017, 101 candidate. You can see here the number of events as a function of the energy, and going fastly. Okay, you can see here the hourly our upper limit estimation. These are the model independent limit. This red is our last result, while the black is the result that we published in 2011. And as you can see, we improved by on average by a factor two our previous limit, but are the best limit below 8 MeV. We have also computed the model dependent limit, but as you can see, there is no strong difference, no strong dependence on the assumed model. And the number that we got is very similar to the one obtained by the Kamlan collaboration, and it is complementary for what concerns the energy range to the one obtained by the Super Kamiokande collaboration. So going to the conclusion, thanks to its exceptional radio purity, Borexino robustly detected the geoneutrino signal. We have excluded the Moormann signal at 99% confidence level, and we show some preference for model predicting high uranium and thorium abundances. Then Borexin has achieved the best upper limit on the diffuse supernova neutrino background for energy below 8 MeV. And we also done analysis of possible signal time correlating with solar flares, gamma ray bursts, and gravitational wave events, observing no excess. And for this particular study, I remind you to the talk I gave on Tuesday. All these results will be updated at the end of the data taking in September 2021. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sandra. Is there any question? No, you were clear. So thank you again, Sandra. And thank you, Sandra. So we close here. And we move now to the last talk of Nicola. So Nicola, can you share your screen?
Okay. Can you see my slides?
Yes, yes.
Can I start?
Yes, you please start.
Okay, thank you. So thank you for the invitation to this talk. I will speak about the first experimental detection of the CNO solar neutrinos in Borexino. Okay, maybe since in this session the solar physics has been discussed largely, I can go quickly through the first slide. Just I remind you that the neutrinos coming from the CNO react total neutrino flux. So it means that it's really difficult from an experimental point of view to detect this very small flux. So the basic, just for making a simple comparison, in Borexino we detect the neutrino through the elastic scattering on the electrons. If we take 100 tons of pseudocumene, that is the scintillator used in Borexino, we have a number of targets that is of order of 10 to 31, considering the average cross-section of the beryllium-7 neutrino and the electron, that is of order of 10 to minus 45 centimeters square, and considering the flux of the beryllium 7 that it's half a billion centimeters square per second, we get something like 48 counts per day per 100 ton. That of course it's a macroscopic and reliable rate, but it's also comparable with the intrinsic radioactivity and the environmental radioactivity that you can find in an underground laboratory. Just keep in mind that one CPD per 100 ton, that is the measure the unit that we use in Borexino for measuring the neutrinos, it's of order of 1.1 nanobecquerel per kilogram. So people who are working in underground laboratories searching for dark matter, searching for double beta, knows very well how challenging it is to get this very high purity in terms of the materials, the target, the scintillator, and also from the environmental radioactivity. So for sure we need underground, we need very high purity, we need large mass. And all these ingredients are very well met by the Borexino experiment. Borexino, just to remind you, that it's located in the Laboratorio Nazionale Gran Sasso, a laboratory of the National Institute of Nuclear Physics. The overburden, the rock that is shielding the lab, corresponds to about 3.8 kilometers of water equivalent. It means that the muon flux and also, of course, also the cosmogenic induced background is reduced by a factor of 1 million. Underground, we have only 1 muon per meter square per hour, that it's very small, but not completely negligible when we use a large detector as Borexino with a large surface. This is just the schematic view of the detector. We know that Borexino is a Matrioska-like detector in which there are different shells of increasing radio purity. The innermost part that is kept in this nylon balloon of in which the thickness is 125 micrometer and it's really transparent, is the real core of the detector in which we reach the desired requirement as the radio purity. Everything is contained in a sphere surrounded by about 2,000 photomultipliers that are the detector for the scintillation light. And everything, the sphere is immersed in an active water Cherenkov Vito that is used for, of course, for vetoing the muons and the cosmogenic induced background underground. These are just a few pictures of the structure holding the photomultipliers, and this is the detector today. Of course, everything is closed. Here we see a picture because we can turn on sometimes the light and take a picture that just to check the status of the detector. On the right, we have the detector as it appears. It appears now in the whole sea. We see that the is covered by this kind of material, and then we will explain later why. And this was also crucial for the CNO detection. So one of the key ingredients for the solar neutrino detection, and in particular for the CNO, of course, is the radio purity. In Borexino, the critical procedure that brought the detector to a kind of unprecedented level of radio purity was the water extraction campaign that was done from mid to 2010 and mid 2011, in which thanks to 6 cycles of the recirculation of the scintillator in high purity water, the background was drastically induced. Before, I told you that the barium-7 interaction rate is something like 50 counts per day per 100 ton. For the CNO, it's even smaller because of CNO, the flux is extremely small, and it's so expected, the signal expected is of order of 5 CPD per 100 ton. So it means that if you want to increase the sensitivity of your detector to this very small flux, you need to reduce a lot the background and make them comparable and lower of the expected signal. Borexino has produced its results in 3 phases. In the first 2 phases, we had basically the high precision measurement of the neutrinos coming from the PP chain. We measured the first evidence of the barium-7, the precise measurement of the PP and PEP neutrinos and boronate. But the CNO required a different phase, we will see now, because we had to improve the detector with a specific thermal insulation campaign in order to further reduce the diffusion of the contaminants inside the liquid scintillator. This was the situation before the CNO. Results from the main fluxes of the PP chain with high precision, published in our Nature paper in 2018. At that time, for the CNO, we had only an upper limit, of course, the stronger, but not a real evidence as it was done later. Just to remind the importance of the Borexino result, because we had the probability to the possibility to scan the electron neutrino survival probability for a very wide energy range, and done with the same experimental technique. It means that this can factor out all possible systematics coming from the different techniques that were used in the past for scanning the different region of the neutrino energy spectrum. So in this plot, we report the measurement of the different flux performed by Borexino only that are perfectly compatible with the MSW matter enhanced scenario in the large mixing angle solution. And about the metallicity of the sun, that is directly related to the neutrino flux, using only the component from the PP chain, we could also disfavor the low metallicity at less than 2 sigma. This is the very famous Borexino edge energy spectrum. The green one is basically the final spectrum when we apply all selection criteria. And the main characteristics of this spectrum is, of course, the fact that we can see by eye the beryllium 7 shoulder between 200 and 400 photoelectron, as expected. The understanding of the Borexino spectrum is quite complex because there are a lot of components. The red one are the species, the components of the solar neutrino flux, in which you can see the beryllium 7, that is a monochromatic line, also for the PEP, monochromatic line that gives this Compton-like structure during the interaction. We have the PEP that is very close to our software threshold. And the rest are all background. And in particular, it's for the CNO sensitivity, we can see that the sensitivity to our detector to the CNO comes basically from this yellow window that I highlighted in this energy spectrum, in which all the other species are negligible, but bismuth background at PP neutrino. And this, of course, when we performed the preliminary sensitivity study about the possibility to detect the CNO neutrino borexino, you know, we understood that if we do not put any prior, any constraint, both on the bismuth and on the PP, we cannot measure, we cannot increase the sensitivity to CNO and perform a measurement. For the PP, the situation is quite easy because we can, assuming the solar standard model and all the results from the solar neutrino, we can, and also the constraint from the luminosity, we can put a very narrow prior on the PP flux of about 1.4%. And when we fix the PP, and as we can see on the right in this kind of composite scales, just to understand the correlation among the three species, if we fix the PP, bismuth and CNO remain anticorrelated. It means that if we fix the bismuth, we get CNO, but also if we fix an upper limit for the bismuth, we get evidence of CNO, because an upper limit on the bismuth goes to a lower limit on the CNO and can quantify the evidence of this flux. And this basically was the strategy that we adopted in our analysis. Since the PEP can be fixed easily, for the bismuth, the situation is more complex, but we had a chance because we know that bismuth is related to the polonium through the lead. and through the secular equilibrium. So if one measures the polonium rate, one can determine independently the bismuth and put this prior in the fit. Of course, for establish the secular equilibrium, you need to basically freeze the detector, stop all the convection inside. And we know from the history, from our history, that there is an unsupported polonium coming out, leaching out from the inner nylon vessel. And so this was a problem. And there was a problem because we had evidence that there were convection motion in the detector due to the thermal, due to temperature change in the experimental hall and basically the seasonal change. In the experimental hall of about 2-3 degrees from the summer with respect to the winter, and from the human activities, because sometimes if one is warming up the experimental hall for doing some other operation related to other experiment, this can change the temperature. And now we know that if we change the temperature of a liquid, you trigger convective motion inside. So the basic idea that we understood starting from the preliminary studies in the early 2012 and 2013, we understood that if we establish a strong vertical gradient, we can prevent the convective motions. This can be easily done in theory in Borexino, because the ground, it's basically the rock of the mountain, and it's a kind of infinite capacity, thermal capacitance. So basically the rock, it's at its own temperature of about 6 degrees, and it's pretty constant during the year. So the idea is to keep the top at that fixed temperature. So first of all, we installed a deep, a very detailed sets of high precision temperature probe. Then we put an insulation layers all around the detector. Then we also put an active control system for keeping constant the temperature on the top of the detector, so keeping a constant the vertical gradient. And in the end, and this was really crucial because it changed a lot the situation of the detector, was the stabilization of the air of the OC directly, putting a resistor in the entrance of the inlet of the conditioning from outside in the room. This is the situation before and after the thermal insulation. We observed, of course, a drastically stabilization within a fraction of degrees of all the probes along the vertical position of the detector. And we saw, we observed immediately an effect on the polonium. Instead of observing this seasonal variation of the polonium related to the convective motion, we observed a pretty well stabilization and the establishment of the condition required for using the secular equilibrium. After this insulation campaign in a data set that goes from mid 2016 up to the beginning of 2020, we observed a very stable region located at about 80 centimeters at the top of the detector that we called the low polonium field, that was used to put the upper limit on the polonium rate, and so the upper limit on the bismuth. Why it's an upper limit? Because the rate that we estimated in this minimum region, it's partially due to it's made of two components. One is the supported term, so the parts that comes through the secular equilibrium from the bismuth. And the other is some residual diffusion that it's not possible to remove completely coming from the vessel. So studying the thermodynamic condition, we understood that this number can be used as an upper limit. So we quantified the systematic related to the process of the estimation. And then we add to the systematics also, the systematic comes coming from the bismuth uniformity, because bismuth is coming from lead. Here we are assuming that lead is uniform inside the detector. Of course, it's not possible to be completely convinced that this is true. So you need to measure how much is the non-uniformity related to the bismuth. So we use different techniques, and we quantified also such possible source of systematics, summing up all the results in quadrature. We got the final constraint for the bismuth that we used in the fit, that is 11.5 plus minus 1.3 counts per day per 100 tons. So now we have all the ingredients for performing the spectral fit. Of the spectral fit is done in a multivariate approach in which we use, for example, also the radial distribution that is different from the intrinsic contaminant and the solar neutrino as compared with, for example, the external background that, of course, are not uniform in the radial direction. So applying the luminosity PEP constraint, the bismuth upper limit, we were able to fit our data and get a positive signal from the CNR. This is the final result. The black curve is the delta chi square that in which we can evaluate our confidence interval that gives the final measurement of the our flux that includes of course also the propagation of all possible sources of systematics coming from the detector modeling. And so this is the hypothesis CNO equal to zero. It's excluded at 5 sigma. And so now we have the 68 interval, the first measurement of the CNO rate that we reported in our Nature paper published last year. Just to mention that the importance of this result, this paper was considered among the top 10 breakthrough in 2020 from the Physics World, that is the magazine on the IOP Society. And we got recently also the Cocconi Prize from the European Physics Society. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Nicola. Thanks for this very clear talk. Is there any question for Nicola? No, so you are very clear. I would like to thank all the speakers. We close now. We close a little before then schedule because we had one talk less, unfortunately. Marco told me to tell you that he regrets for this, but he had a sudden commitment with the executive committee of INFN, so he could not join us. In any case, the session has been extremely complete and interesting. So thanks to everybody. And we close here the session. Thank you.
Bye, Gioacchino.
Ciao, bye bye. Bye, everybody.
Bye bye.
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 Bye.